Hi guys, I welcome you all to the video number 3 on Kurukshetra of May 2018 based on the theme Technology for Rural Development. So let's start our discussion with new technologies in irrigation sector. Now India has a net irrigated area of around 68.1 million hectares as per 2013-14, and this is irrigated by canals, tube wells and wells and other sources. Gross irrigated area is around 95.77 million hectares, and India has one of the largest irrigated areas in the world. 49% of the gross cropped area is under some degree of assured irrigation, and the rest of 51% cropped area is dependent on seasonal rainfall. Largest share of irrigated area is concentrated in the states of Northwest India, that is Punjab, Haryana and Western UP. So these are the states in which irrigation facilities are generally available to a larger extent, and Punjab is the only state in India which has almost 100% irrigated agriculture. So irrigation facilities are more developed in the northwestern part of India. Now if you look at the irrigation development in India, this takes us way back to the Green Revolution in 1970s, and with the advent of Green Revolution in 1970s, there was an urgent need. There was a need that we provide irrigation to moisture-sensitive improved dwarf varieties of rice and wheat. So new kinds of rice and wheat varieties are being developed at those time, and there was a need to provide timely irrigation to those new kind of varieties, which could not be fulfilled only with slow pace of development of canal irrigation. So that's why a need was felt that we need to work on the irrigation front in India. The additional demand was fulfilled with the rapid development of shallow groundwater tube wells, which provided the irrigation on demand and in areas outside the canal demand. So this particular demand led to rapid development of tube wells so as to fulfill the increasing irrigation demands in the country. Now, as far as groundwater is concerned, India is now the largest user of groundwater in the world. 71% of the tube wells are energized by electricity, and the rest mostly in the eastern region of the country. Eastern region of the country comprises the states of Odisha, West Bengal, etc. I have to depend upon the costly diesel-based irrigation. Now, this has caused massive over-exploitation of groundwater resources. So, we are increasingly using tube wells, and this has caused massive over-exploitation of groundwater resources. And a rapid decline of groundwater levels and rise in critical and semi-critical groundwater blocks in the country. So, this particular increased use of tube wells has hampered the groundwater resources of the country. 11 states of UP, Maharashtra, MP, Gujarat, Punjab, Andhra Pradesh and Bihar have almost 90% of the total minor irrigation structure in the country. So if you look at the new initiatives which are there in the irrigation sector, they include improving the conveyance efficiency of surface irrigation. This includes setting up pipe water facilities to connect dams, canals and micro irrigation systems so that they can reduce water loss and increase overall water use efficiency up to 90%. So we are increasing the conveyance efficiency of surface irrigation through use of piped water facilities to connect dams, canals and micro irrigation systems. So micro irrigation systems are very helpful in reducing water loss and increasing the water use efficiency. Next is underground taming of floods for irrigation. Now, successful models have been developed and demonstrated by the International Water Management Institute at Rampur District in UP and elsewhere also. And this successful model have been also included in district irrigation plans for underground taming of floods for irrigation. So this is also another key initiative, the recent initiatives which are being worked upon in the irrigation sector. And then there is evergreen concept of micro irrigation. Now, the use of micro irrigation techniques like use of drips, sprinklers, micro sprinklers, tapes, guns help in improving application efficiency of the irrigation. So micro irrigation can help in improving the application efficiency of irrigation. And then there are other initiatives like laser land leveling, zero tillage, aerobic rice and system of rice intensification, which are also other some notable initiatives in the irrigation sector. Now let us move to solar irrigation. Now Solar Pump Irrigators Cooperative Enterprise or SPICE in Gujarat is one of the worthwhile models in this regard. Successful models such as Spark or Solar Power as second remunerative crop at Dundi are working and can be scaled up by NABARD and other agencies. So the SPICE and Spark models are related to solar power, more particularly related to solar irrigation. Now these projects may be capital intensive at initial stages because you may be required to set up some few solar infra, and the government will have to figure out smarter ways to mobilize funds for this kind of system. Now let us look at the strategies and technologies, practices and policies with regard to irrigation development. So first one is improved usage of surface and groundwater, and the technologies, practices and policies related to this one include laser land leveling of fields, optimum size of basins, furrows, raised beds, conveyance pipes, underground distribution systems, proper canal schedules, irrigation schedules, well-maintained distribution networks, use of remote sensing, GIS sensors, drones and ICT technologies for improved irrigation, use of smart card based community tube wells, pricing of water and power to recover their full costs, use of solar pumps and increased use of solar energy to be fed back into the grid with particular focus for the east. And then there is a strategy of improved use of rainfall. For this, we can develop catchment water harvesting systems. We can synchronize our crop planting and transplantation with the onset of monsoon. We can also use improved water retention techniques like use of mulches, draining excess water, use of rainfall for recharging the groundwater, like the underground taming of floods for irrigation, use of agromet advisory services, use of crop insurance, and the technologies and techniques for drought and flood management. Next is reducing non-beneficial uses of water and water quality deterioration. So this involves improved canopy structure through agronomy and plant breeding. So we adopt the practices which are commensurate with the reduction in non-beneficial uses of water, and we can also practice zero and minimum tillage. We can focus on increased use of micro irrigation. We can even use plastic and residue mulches, and we can even do boundary plantations so that the water remains within the boundaries. And then there can be peri-urban agriculture and the safe use of waste water. Next is improving crop yields and water productivity. Now this involves providing incentives for structures for water efficient crops through the price and procurement policies of the government. It also involves providing subsidies to the farmers so that farmers can decide which crops they want to grow, breeding of superior crop varieties with higher yield, stress and disease tolerance, precision irrigation, that is synchronizing water application with the crop water demand, and soil fertility management, which can be done through crop rotation, tillage and targeted application of nutrients and fertilizers. And then there is disease, pest and weed management, which always remains an important concept with regard to agriculture scenario in India. Now let us move on to the droughts and farm pond technology. Now this involves collecting surface runoff from the catchment area. Now this one is an ex situ method for water conservation and is also referred to as on-farm reservoir. Now construction of farm ponds require large catchment area with minimum slope of around 1 to 2%, and even small farm ponds of size 100 to 300 meter cube can be dug up for storing runoff water. Now having capacity of 250 to 300 meter cube for each hectare of catchment area is the ideal to collect runoff. So the ideal capacity is 250 to 300 meter cube, but we can also have small farm ponds of smaller sizes around 300 to 300 meter cube for storing runoff water. Now seepage and evaporation are the two main problems which are associated with the farm ponds. Now let us look at the benefits of farm ponds. Now farm ponds provide water for part or full of year depending on its size. So if you are having a bigger pond, you can use the water from the pond for a greater part of the year to meet your irrigation needs or other kinds of needs. Now, if the farm pond is filled in summer and then there is late onset of monsoon in June, harvested water can be utilized for sowing and establishment of rain-fed crop. So, if you are having water in your farm pond, you need not wait for the monsoon, and if the monsoon is late, you can use this kind of water for sowing and establishment of rain-fed crops, for example, rice. Now, it has also been seen that farm pond of 900 metric cube capacity, which was dug up in Garkampet village in Adilabad district of Telangana, now it got filled during the first week of August 2008, and water was retained till February 2009, even after use. So, this was a big farm pond, and you can see how the construction of farm ponds can be a game changer for rural scenario in India. So now let us look at combating drought through farm pond technology. Now farm ponds are considered as the best mechanism to mitigate drought in rain-fed rural areas. So farm ponds can act as an insurance so that you can protect yourself during the droughts in the rain-fed rural areas. The government is also encouraging viable technology and is also supporting farmers through subsidies in this regard. That is for promotion of construction of farm ponds for combating drought. But the main hindrance for implementation is the loss of 5 to 10% of farmland. So whenever you have to construct a farm pond, you may have to devote a part of your farm land for constructing that particular pond. So this will lead to loss of around 5 to 10% of the farmland, and this is one of the main hindrance for implementation of this farm pond technology for combating droughts. Now the floods and water logging, which follow heavy and incessant rainfall, causes destruction of crops, life and prosperity, and it is ideal that if we manage those floods, if we manage those excess water into farm ponds for use at a later on stage for our crops or for other local needs. Now the production in rain-fed ecosystem in India is not exceeding 1 ton per hectare as compared to around 2.5 ton per hectare under irrigated ecosystem. So presently the productivity of irrigation irrigated ecosystem is higher and the rain-fed ecosystem is lower, and if we are able to effectively utilize this farm pond technology, we may be able to improve the productivity of rain-fed ecosystems as well. Now let us look at the different government agencies which are extending support for farm ponds and water storage structures. So there is National Horticulture Board, which is extending support through its horticulture department for various horticulture crops. And then there is Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Program, or MG Narega. So under this particular act, we are providing guaranteed employment to rural people, and through this particular scheme, we are focusing on increased construction of storage structures under this particular program. And then there is National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, that is NABARD, which is also extending finance for construction of farm ponds and water storage structures. Also the Hill Area Development Program and the Tribal Area Development Program are having special emphasis on construction of farm ponds and water storage structures in hilly areas and tribal areas of the country. Also, there is a scheme that is Member of Parliament Local Area Development Scheme, through which the Member of Parliament can devote funds for development of local areas in their particular constituency, and through this particular scheme also funds are being channelized for construction of farm ponds and water storage structures. And then there is Integrated Watershed Management Program, which is a key component of Pradhan Mantri Krishi Sinchai Yojana. And the key focus of this particular component, this particular program, is also construction of water storage structures and watershed management in the country. And then there is Backward Regions Grant Fund and MG Narega. And from this particular fund, also we are providing facilities, we are extending financing mechanism to the rural areas for construction of water storage structures. Now, ICAR, or the Indian Council of Agriculture Research, is also promoting new technologies for rural areas. Now, to increase the productivity and to reduce the cost of cultivation, to reduce the manual labor, to improve the value addition, and to conserve the resources, and providing alternate means for generating energy, ICAR is working towards improved farm mechanization during the last few years. So, Indian Council of Agriculture Research is also focusing on improved farm mechanization to cater to different aspects of agriculture lands and the agriculture as an occupation in India. And it is not just concerned with agriculture, it is not just limited to agriculture, its scope is very wide, and it is also working in the area of fisheries. And in this particular area of fisheries, it has developed breeding and seed production technology of 9 food fish species. It has also developed technology of marine cage farming and is disseminating it through 1500 cages which are located in different states of India. And it is also working on 4 feeds for different life stages of important fish and shrimp species and their commercialization. Breeding and seed production technology for 9 ornamental fishes. So ICAR is playing a crucial role in developing new technologies for rural areas. Now let us move on to the next topic, which is reducing drudgery through technology. Now drudgery refers to hard, menial or dull work. All labor intensive works lead to drudgery or fatigue in form of physical or mental stress. So drudgery is some kind of a hard, menial or dull work. So you have to do some complicated work which is dull, boring and very unskilled. So this is drudgery. And in the agriculture front, we have examples of women farmers who have been facing different kinds of problems through as a result of drudgery. And the problems include depression, anemia, abortion, miscarriage and other gynecological problems. So if we are able to use technology, if we are able to use new kinds of technological interventions, we can reduce this drudgery. And if the farmers are made aware with the available drudgery reducing tools and equipments, this would not only help in drudgery reduction, but will also increase their capability, productivity and improved efficiency. For example, if the women farmers are made aware about the different kinds of drudgery reducing tools, they can use these tools and this will eventually reduce their time at work. Plus, it will also keep them healthier and will ultimately promote a healthier India. Now, intervention of farm technologies and drudgery reducing technologies has played a key role in enhancing agriculture productivity under the National Food Security Mission for 12th Plan. So, the introduction of drudgery reducing equipments and drudgery reducing technology is one of the key components under the National Food Security Mission. And this comprised of production of additional 25 million tons of food grains, which included 10 million tons of rice and an even amount of wheat, 3 million tons of pulses and 2 million tons of millet. So National Food Security Mission and inculcation of drudgery reducing technologies in the same has been instrumental in increasing the production of food grains in the country. Now let us look at the different technology interventions for minimizing drudgery. So these include ergonomically designed cotton picking bags, which have been designed by the Marathwada Agriculture University and the Haryana Agriculture University. Now they have a higher carrying capacity and are significantly superior over conventional picking bags. And then there are tubular maize shellers, sitting type groundnut detorticator, seed treatment drum, Naveen sickle and groundnut stripper. They have also been introduced in the past to reduce farmers' drudgery. Use of sitting type groundnut decorticator, and this reduces the finger pain and hand pain, backache, tooth pain and cuts in mouth. So by using this particular groundnut decorticator, you can reduce different kinds of pains which may otherwise be there in using conventional technologies. Use of groundnut stripper has also reduced the hand pain, shoulder pain and waist pain by significant amounts. Now the use of Naveen sickle has also helped reducing cuts on fingers which were earlier there due to rubbing of hand in harvesting ground level crops. It has also reduced pain in waist and hand and physical tiredness which was caused by the use of local sickle. And also then there is ICAR, CIAE, that is the Central Institute of Agriculture Engineering in Bhopal, MP, which is a nationally and internationally premier agriculture engineering and research and development institution, and it is devoted to develop and promote appropriate technologies for land development, farm mechanization, irrigation, processing of agro produce, utilizing renewable and mechanical power resources. So ICAR, CIAE, that is the Central Institute of Agriculture Engineering in Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh, is a national and international premier agriculture engineering research institution which is also working in developing important tools for minimizing drudgery. Seed drill. Now, in traditional method, furrow is opened by hand, hoe in soil, and seeds are placed. Operations are done in bending posture, and this bending posture causes pain in waist and back of farmers. Now, using this seed drill, using this particular tool, the metering of seed is done by a fluted roller, which is operated by the ground wheel by sprocket and chain mechanism. So, you can easily plant your seeds without causing any pain in the waist and back of farmers. The capacity of this tool is 0.04 hectares per hour. Next is hand ridger. Now, while doing farming operations, women farmers very often have to bend or squat, and they have to pull soil towards them to make small ridges and furrows. Now, this puts strain, and they ultimately result in pain in back as well as shoulders, and they ultimately complain of spondylitis. Now, hand ridger is incredibly simple and a very useful tool, a labor-saving improved equipment, which comprises two heart-shaped metallic wings and a pulling beam with a T-type handle. So, with this particular technique, you can easily do your farming operations. And capacity of this particular equipment is around 0.03 hectare per hour, and it is available at a cost of just rupees 700. Next is twin wheel hoe weeder. Now, traditional manual weeding by hand hoe, that is khurpi, is a labor intensive process. Farmers usually have to bend and keep moving in the field while they take out weeds and remove unwanted vegetative growth between rows plants. Now, this causes pain as well as the stiffness in the waist, neck and back of the farmers in the long run due to the bending squatting posture. With the use of twin wheel hoe weeder, which is a simple push and pull action technique, we can effectively remove weeds easily without having to bend and without having to suffer the different consequences of traditional manual weeding techniques. And then there is an improved sickle. Now, improved sickle has a long serrated blade. It is lightweight and less force is required to shear the grass. Also, there is better grip and the sharpness of the blade is also long lasting, and this particular sickle is also available at a very nominal cost. So, harvesting cereal crops is usually done by the local women workers, and who are generally using the local sickle. Now, this local sickle is heavy, weighing around 300 to 350 grams. This causes pain in the wrist. On the other hand, if we use the improved sickle, which is lightweight and also has improved efficiency, we can do a work in lower amount of time and with lesser toil or lesser labor. Next is coconut dehusker. Now, traditionally dehusking of coconut is being done using sharp iron shovel, which is locally known as munna, and this is fixed on wooden log or with the help of a long knife. And this particular technique, as it seems also, is quite dangerous and accident prone. Now, with the use of coconut dehusker, we can split open a coconut partially at several points, and then we can easily do the dehusking by hands at in a very simple manner. Now, let us look at the government schemes and awareness generation programs for promoting technology interventions in agriculture sector in rural areas. Now, schemes include macro management of agriculture, National Food Security Mission, Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana and National Horticulture Mission. Now, in all these particular schemes, our focus is on improved technology interventions in the agriculture sector so as to ultimately increase the production and productivity of the different kinds of crops which are being grown in the country. Now, under the different kinds of schemes, government has distributed nearly 30.16 lakh improved farm machineries, including water-saving devices and drudgery-reducing equipments. So, around more than 30 lakh equipments, more than 30 lakh farm machineries have been distributed till now by the government under different schemes. Also, a multimedia compendium have been prepared on women-friendly farm tools for reducing drudgery in agriculture, and this has been brought out by Vigyan Prasar. Now, let us move to generating clean energy from waste. Now, with the improved use of new kind of technologies, we can also generate clean energy from waste. Now, in India, there is over 230 million tons of surplus biomass with the potential of over 1 lakh crore fossil fuel import replacement. So, this is a very high amount we can replace. We are having a potential of replacing over 1 lakh crore fossil fuels imports with the use of surplus biomass which we are having. Now, the use of some first generation technologies which involve animal biodung gas, ethanol from sugars and starch, biodiesel production and power generation are not much competitive. Why? Due to market forces and due to availability of better alternative technologies. So their prices are not competitive and the technology is also outdated. So we are gradually moving towards second generation technologies which are aiming towards cost effective import substitution and pollution free biofuel production. Now the budget of 2018-19 also envisages incentives for waste to wealth, and in this particular regard Gobardhan scheme has been announced, which focuses on realizing rupees 1 lakh crore economy focused on bio CNG generation. So Gobardhan stands for Galvanizing Organic Bio Agro Resources Dhan, which will help in promoting cleanliness as well as the improving the income of the farmers. So Gobardhan scheme will contribute towards management and conversion of cattle dung and solid waste in farms to compost, fertilizer, biogas and bio CNG. Now in this particular regard, it is important to point out that India has a cattle population of around 300 million. So there is a huge amount of dung which is there, and we can if we effectively manage, we can get a huge amount of compost, fertilizer, biogas and bio CNG made out of it. Also, the huge population depicts enormous potential for biogas, considering the dung production of roughly 10 kg per capita and 25 kg of dung produces 1 metric cube of biogas as a rule of thumb. So, we can work wonders if we are able to use this biodung, if we are able to use this cattle dung effectively to produce biogas, bio CNG and other compost and fertilizers, etc. Now let us briefly look at the evolution of biogas technologies in India. Now the first biogas plant was designed at Indian Agriculture Research Institute by N.V. Joshi. Now earlier plants were expensive, they were prone to explosions and the efficiency of those plants were also lower to be commercially viable. And then there was a development of floating dom model by Jashbhai Patel, and it was promoted by KVIC, that is Khadi and Village Industry Commission, in the name of KVIC model. Towards the end of 1975 to 81, our biogas program was inducted into 20 point program which is designed by the Government of India, followed by the National Program for Biogas Development by the Ministry of Agriculture. So we were increasingly focusing towards biogas development by the 1980s, and in 1984 a new design called Deen Bandhu biogas plant was introduced, and it was considered to reduce the installation costs further. In 1996 there was 7 biogas plant designs which were available in the market, which include Janata, Deen Bandhu and Flexi design. So you can see how we are continuously evolving biogas technologies in India. More evolution and more advancements in this regard can prove to be a game changer with regard to generation of bioenergy and biogas in the country. So guys, this was all about the third video on Kurukshetra of May 2018, and with the completion of this video we have officially completed the Kurukshetra of May 2018. We have completed the theoretical aspect and we are going to cover MCQs in the next particular video. Thank you.